MedCram.com.
Well, thanks everyone for joining us. I am privileged to have Dr. Rishi Desai on. He is an amazing clinician and amazing educator. Well, let's just start with the clinician part first. First of all, he's a pediatric infectious disease specialist at Stanford University. But even more importantly, Rishi, you were, as far as I'm concerned, one of the stalwarts and the pillars of flipping the classroom on YouTube and on the internet because you worked with Khan Academy. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, thank you for inviting me, Roger, to hang out with you a bit. I started there because I was excited about kind of making online tutorials, making videos. And so I started doing that with them, mostly around kind of pre-med topics, and it kind of got into MCAT, so getting kids into medical school, and I loved doing it. And then about 3 years ago, I switched over to Osmosis and continued kind of helping to make videos, but now have moved roles. So now there's a whole team of folks that make videos, and I just love doing it. It's a lot of fun.
I think the problem today has been is trying to figure out what information do we need to know and what information can we just look up? What do you think?
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more. And when I have fellows and residents with me now, I care more about who has the best question than who has the best answer. And what I mean by that is, like, you know, you walk by a patient who's on dialysis, and if you don't even think to question how that affects their medications, because now the meds are getting dialyzed off, if you don't even think to ask that question, then you'll never even think about redosing their medications. Right. But if the question pops up in your head, then you can easily go look up or talk to a pharmacist about kind of figuring out how to redose their medication. So I think the best doctors are the ones that are kind of coming up with the right questions and thinking about things. And then the easier part is then going to look things up.
I remember becoming a third year medical student. I mean, I'd be getting up at 5, 6 in the morning, going in, doing rounds, coming home at 5, exhausted, and then realizing that I still have to study. And you'd look up the syllabus and they say, okay, here's Harrison's, right? I mean, it's like a doorstop. One of the things that has come up recently here in the media has been the new hypertension guidelines. And I think it's a great example of all of the issues that are plaguing medical education. For instance, they always used to tell us, we're teaching it here in medical school, but we'll have to tell you up front, 50% of what we're teaching you is wrong. We just don't know what 50% it is. And here we have the new hypertension guidelines.
Yeah, exactly. And I would love to hear your take on them, because I think these guidelines get a lot of play on Facebook and Twitter and things like that. But it's good to dive into and understand kind of what the changes are, because it's such a major, major thing that affects all Americans and frankly, people around the world.
Right. And I know you've uploaded a video that's gone over these, and we've done the same, because I think it's important. The implications are enormous. We're talking hundreds of thousands, millions of people. We're talking about medications, pharmaceutical companies. Everybody has their say about, you know, is this a push towards pharmaceutical companies? Is this a push away from that? Lifestyle, diet. So, if we just look at what the guidelines are, there's actually a lot of interesting material there. The first thing is that the last time these guidelines really came out and were comprehensive was back in 2003. So this is 14 years in the making. There's a lot of political issues with this. The National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute basically handed over the responsibility of these guidelines back in 2013 to the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association. And so they've picked up with it, and now they've come up with these guidelines. But what's interesting about these guidelines, first, two things. Number one is the classification. Both the old and the new guidelines agree that a blood pressure of less than 120 systolic is okay, it's normal. And both guidelines agree that any blood pressure above 140 is abnormally high. Where they differ is that sweet spot between systolic 120 and 139. And whereas before they were called pre-hypertension, they wouldn't get a diagnosis. You know, if somebody told you that you had pre-whatever, you're going to like, well, that means I don't have it, right? So now, on the other hand, instead of them not having it, they've taken that sweet spot of 120 to 139, and they've done a little bit of risk stratification. They've said that if you're between 120 and 130 or 129, that lower region, you've got something called elevated blood pressure. Do they just call it elevated? You get a diagnosis of hypertension. You get the ICD-10 code for that, whatever it's going to be. And why is that? Well, they've looked at new research, and those people are about 2 times higher the risk of getting coronary disease and stroke. So what they're recommending for those people is not necessarily pharmacological therapy, but lifestyle. Then they take the second strata between 130 and 139, and they say, okay, this is now stage 1 hypertension. But not everybody has to go on medication. There's about 30% of those people who have either coronary disease or they've got a greater than 10% chance of developing coronary disease in the next 10 years. And they say those are the people that we should start on pharmacotherapy. Whereas before, they would just be pre-hypertension. They wouldn't be getting it. So the question is are there going to be more people diagnosed with hypertension? The answer is yes. Are there going to be more people on medications for hypertension? I think the answer is going to be yes. And so they're getting more and more aggressive. So the question is where did all this come from? Well, they looked at all of these studies. And the big study to look at, if you're interested, is a study called SPRINT. And what they found, and they excluded diabetics from this, so that's important, but what they found is that reducing blood pressure to below 120 as opposed to just 140 actually reduced coronary artery disease, cardiovascular death, and CHF. So that's basically the new guidelines in a nutshell. And there's a lot of reverberation going on in the net and through the society. So we'll see what happens.
Yeah, that's a very succinct and accurate explanation. I think one thing that I always think about is, you know, anytime you're moving the goalposts, as it were, the ultimate goalpost you really care about, the thing we all care about, is not like what label and what drug even, but are you preventing deaths, which you alluded to, and are you preventing bad outcomes? And we'll see, you know, in 5-10 years, if giving more meds now, which is pretty much what everyone agrees is going to happen, really does those things. And we hope it does. We hope it prevents deaths, prevents, you know, real severe hypertension from developing, because you started earlier, you were more aware of it. And the analogy would be, you know, something like colon cancer, where if I know that, you know, I've got, you know, some sort of familial polyp disorder, or if I know that there's a lot of colon cancer in my family, I'm going to get early screening. I'm going to be more vigilant about it. So that's your 120 to 129 range, where that elevated hypertension, I'm going to be thinking about it more, maybe getting more frequent checks than I otherwise would have, because we know that that seems to be predictive of a bad outcome down the road. It makes sense, and I understand why, but I also understand that the concern around, you know, these major, major powerful groups getting more money, getting more patients using their medications and things like that.
Exactly. I think what's important is that they're, at least they're stating that they're, that what's driving this is evidence-based. And I think the evidence is there. The other interesting thing about this is the way we monitor blood pressure. And, you know, back in the 1980s, 1990s, how do we get blood pressure medication? How do we get blood pressure readings? We got it by going into a doctor's office and some healthcare professional measuring our blood pressure. Now, what do we have? We have Fitbits, right? We can know more about the human body when we're not in the doctor's office than we ever dreamed of. What they're noticing and what the issue is that, you know, blood pressure is a result of your environment. If you're under stress, you're going to have a higher blood pressure. And so anytime anybody goes to the doctor's office, they could be under a little bit more stress. And so what they're finding is that these ambulatory blood pressure monitoring and home blood pressure monitoring are typically a little bit lower than what we're seeing in the doctor's office. And so if we're going to be using those to generate hypotheses, It makes sense that we're probably going to have to lower down that classification to meet those numbers.
Yeah, exactly. And that point is huge, right? Like right now we see a doctor maybe once a year, maybe twice a year. That's a snapshot. You know, that's literally like taking a Polaroid camera and just snapping 2 quick shots, you know, and that's all you get. And what you're moving towards is a movie, where you just watch someone continuously and you get such a rich understanding of kind of what their blood pressure is doing and blood sugar is doing and all this kind of stuff. And so we're going to see much more of this correcting of guidelines as we get better and better data sets and saying, okay, you know what, a one-time check of 135, that actually means that probably most of the time, as you correctly pointed out, you're riding at 140, 145. And so as you see that and correlate that, we're going to get more and more accurate assessments of who really is at risk and who isn't.
Right. And it's almost analogous to the hemoglobin A1C, right? Which is a built-in average of your 3-month blood sugar.
Exactly. And we don't have that for hypertension yet, but you know, you could easily imagine that we have a new measure that, you know, as you said, 50% of what you know in 2 years, we'll be doing this again, you and I, And we'll talk about how you know the guidelines are out because we have better data sets, and now we call it the hypertension A1C or whatever it is, but like some long-term measure of hypertension rather than just a snapshot.
The other thing that they talked about that I was surprised at was this thing called white coat hypertension. I remember when I was, quote, growing up, I remember studying MixApp, if you remember MixApp. MixApp was that thing for internal medicine. And I remember studying a MixApp question. And the thing you had to know for this question was that white coat hypertension was a risk factor for getting left ventricular hypertrophy. Right. So now what are they noticing? That fits into the 50% that was wrong. What they're noticing is white coat hypertension, which again is you have a normal blood pressure at home and you come into the doctor's office and it's a little bit elevated. Well, when you follow these patients out, their risk for coronary events is the same as those who are normal tensive. So in other words, if we take that blood pressure reading in the office, we could be treating patients that don't really need to be treated. I teach over at Loma Linda University. One of the things that we've been doing is every 3 or 4 months, I have to go in and teach the third year medical students about the pulmonary aspect of medicine. And we try to do that in 3 hours. So imagine going in at 1 o'clock in the afternoon and coming out at five, and it's just me talking for 4 hours about everything from the five mechanisms of hypoxemia to the reasons why someone gets a pulmonary embolism. Now what we've done is we've put that whole lecture now online, and now what I do when we go in is we have like a little Jeopardy session, medical Jeopardy. So we do that for about an hour. And then after that, we go up to the simulation lab. And for the next hour, we talk about a case, we simulate a case. And I think that's kind of part and parcel of what flipping the classroom is. But Rishi, tell me, one of the biggest barriers that I see, at least on our side, and you can tell me what you see on your side, is sometimes the students just don't get down and look at the material before the class. What's the best way that you found to make sure and make sure that happens?
Yeah, that's the biggest issue. And a lot of faculty struggle with this as well. At Stanford, one thing that they've done is they've started doing almost like, and actually some of the meetups are in physical spaces that are not in the classroom. So they'll have a few faculty members, like five faculty, sign up for a random Friday night to go to a really nice bar or a really nice restaurant. And they'll invite students to come to that place and just talk to faculty about whatever they want to talk about. And the idea is that you would only go there if you want to or they'd have a discussion topic, like let's talk about hypertension. And the idea was that you'd only go there if you've actually prepared for it. If I'm going to go and somehow a social setting seems different. I think sometimes when you go to a physical place like a lecture hall, because we're pre-programmed to think we're going to get spoon-fed, like you and I were, that's what you should kind of be used to. But somehow just moving the physical space to a different space gets people in a different mindset. Like, oh, I'm going almost like a book club. If I'm going to go to the book club, I'm going to read the book. I'm not just going to go to the book club if I haven't read the book. And same idea, like you would only go to these meetups with faculty if you've actually done the pre-work. And it becomes really evident when you go to these places and you haven't done the pre-work that you aren't able to participate as fully. And so I think that's been one kind of small trick, but it's a psychological trick. It's just literally moving the space to a different location. And people start kind of only going and only signing up to go if they've done the pre-work. And it's kind of a neat thing because then less people show up, frankly, because the people that haven't done the work don't show up. And that's fine. Then they can go, stay home and do the pre-work while the folks that do show up have a rich discussion about it.
It's about engagement and getting them engaged in lifelong learning. I know these are all catchphrases, but it does have actual meaning.
Yeah. And I mean, as a med student, a lot of the value you get is not from your faculty or from your books, it's from your peers, right? Like the people that I really trust today are the people that I studied with, that I grew up with, essentially my cohort. And so if your cohort isn't enriching your experience, that sucks. And if you're not enriching theirs, you're kind of the reason that it's making it suck for them. So I think that that's an important piece, is that when you start med school or nursing school or anything, you have a responsibility to your peers to do your work. And that's not just to yourself, but it's to your peers. And if you can kind of frame it that way, then you're not just letting yourself down when you don't prepare, you're letting everyone down. Now, the problem is that so many people get caught up, in bad classrooms, not understanding some basic thing. You're like, that's not the hard part. You can cram that part. The part that you shouldn't be cramming is the discussion in terms of how it applies to someone. You know, and that's what it should be. Like, our videos are just like yours. They're short videos. I want them to be short because I think that that's the easy bit. You know, it's easy to just understand the new guidelines. But what's hard is, you know, understanding how it applies to a person and saying, okay, here's a 17-year-old person comes in with blah, blah, blah. What would you do? That's the part you can't cram away.
Well, Dr. Desai, I really appreciate you taking the time to meet with us and to talk with our MedCram subscribers and viewers out there. I think that we are together making a difference one video at a time.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Roger. I appreciate it.